Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for inviting me in this very high-level meeting. I must say about ecosystem change and ecosystem services and biodiversity, a range of issues which ICRAF, World Agroforestry Center, is dealing with. Some of you in the audience will say, oh, Cheikh again talking about agroforestry. Yes, I will keep preaching agroforestry. And mostly after a whole night of dancing and wine, it won't be difficult to convince you at the end of my presentation about the importance of agroforestry, mostly in Africa. Many of the keynote you have seen is trying to see how much theory and the practical implications of those theory can make transformative change in Africa. I'm trying to get another angle, trying to see the real practice in Africa, which is ongoing in terms of, you know, land management, and trying to see what theory we can build out of that and try to reconcile the decision making and the real practice in the ground. Because at the end of the day, my belief is a successful policy is the one which is supporting what communities need and what community aspiration is. And I think in the smallholder farming, there is a big deal of combining multifunctional role of the landscape to achieve different perspective or different development needs. And that's why I suggested to the PECs to now come and talk about the contribution of agroforestry to bridge the resource needs of poor countries or poor dwellers to the ecosystem services and biodiversity conservation. I'm working for the World Agroforestry Center, a CG center based in, headquarters based in Nairobi. And we are about 630 scientists working in different perspective or different aspect of agroforestry, from germplasm to domestication, to market value chain, to ecosystem services, to soil health and soil fertility, to ecosystem services themselves, and climate change, where I belong. So, just to give you some highlights, the first highlight we have here, which I think will be a take-home message at the end of this presentation, is that diversification of agro-system can really support agro-biodiversity and biodiversity in general, and all ecological process in farming lands. We think that agroforestry is sort of balancing the steady, tendency to do monocropping as it appears from the Green Revolution. And we have seen that recently many countries have developed agroforest policies to really correct the drawbacks of this Green Revolution or this monoculture approach. The EU has adopted agroforestry in their common policy. Recently, India has put on the table $500 million to really bring back agroforestry into their landscape. There are some reasons why these things happen. That's a failure and the limitation of the traditional agriculture system, and I will come back to that. The second highlight is about the issue of complex possibilities or complex combination of trees with crops and livestock in the ground. So there is no silver bullet in agroforestry. There's so many options by context, and we should be trying to see how much those options can be helping managing biodiversity and forest resources on the ground. And the third highlight is agroforestry can enhance sustainability. We talk about climate change impact. We cannot go around it. I just discussed with some South African colleagues who just mentioned many consecutive years of drought and the impact of that drought in food security in South Africa. And I think it's related to the type of farming which also used in South Africa, not only the drought itself as an impact from climate, but also the way we manage land and in addressing these resilience issues. And Belinda gave us a good framework of understanding this multiplicity of entry point in addressing the resilience issues. So Africa is characterized, so to speak, different farming system, difference in purpose and planning, and difference in scales. And I will come back to the scales at the end of the presentation. So what is the problem about? I just mentioned a couple of things. My first, big issues, which is like the problem statement, is the current productive models. During colonial time, the first thing which was important, the knowledge-intensive agriculture system which was imported during colonial time, was like ban tree from the landscape. And the real livelihood of communities in Africa is a combination of trees within the landscape. The simple reason was, let's use the steady machineries to quickly produce the maximum you know, supplies and commodities to feed some countries in the north. And that was really a starting point, or a tipping point, somebody may say, or shifting regimes, somebody may also say, or social change, which have brought the communities to change the way they do agriculture in a traditional way. Because traditionally, agroforestry was the way of doing cultivation. So this current productive system are inorganic fertilizers, high yielding variety and considerably increasing production. It has solved the problem of production, but did not solve the problem of preserving the natural capital. The second thing is the ecological damage of degradation which is related to that practice. Unsustainable practice results to lower yield in the long run. Some areas, I come from Senegal, where we have what we call the peanut basin, and there is very interesting studies from the IRD, the French Research Center, which was showing over time how much carbon was taken out of the soil. Because that's a productive system where you export everything. You export the groundnut, you export the grass, you export everything. And at the end of the day, there is no restitution of organic matter in the soil. A soil without any biomass is unlikely to retain any fertilizer. When rains comes, everything is going to be leached out, everything is going to run off. And that's something we're just learning now, and trying to bring back trees in the ground to be playing the role of biological pump, and bring the role of natural fertilizer and a reconstruction of the soil biomass and the soil organic matter, so as to improve not only soil fertility, but to improve the performance of crops when you use fertilizers to really dope or increase, boost the production local level. Increasing yield without damaging the biodiversity is all about the question we are talking about. Recently, the African Development Bank, for those who follow the new investment paradigm of the African Development Bank, is to convert Africa into a net importer of food to a net exporter of food. But we can't do that simply by adopting the old paradigm of Green Revolution. We have to see what are the best practices that combine improve yield and sustainability, and biodiversity and ecosystem services is part of it. Because farmers do not only live with crops, they live also with fruits, they live with medicinal plants, they live with leaves, they live with bark, they live with energy, wood energy, and they need all of these things to make a good livelihood for better landscape, which is their aspiration. I take this picture from colleagues from, you know, ICRAF to show the real impact of deforestation across the world. This paper is submitted to Nature Communication, and it shows about 50% of the global tree cover, many millions of hectares, which has been lost historically to make space for agricultural landscape. So think about it. When we talk about deforestation, we have so many programs, Red Plus, woodlots, plantation, and all these things. But I believe strongly that these large areas of farming land are suited to improve tree density globally without jeopardizing crop production. Just think about 5% increase of trees in landscape across the globe. How many millions of trees and carbon sequestration and soil organic matter reconstruction you can have. Look at the red spots here and the yellow spots where deforestation was taking place, and try to improve just tree cover in those areas. That would be a global impact which would be unprecedented on us. And that's what we are trying to preach. And I see some people looking at me as a preacher, so I keep preaching on this on this process. But now, this impact thing, Belinda mentioned it, some colleagues, Gary and others mentioned the Anthropocene, the issue of impact and responding to impact. It's not an easy thing to assess. How much do we see and how much do we evaluate the land degradation process when it comes to comparing a simple matrix, extraction rate and natural capital? If you take the far extreme where you have high resource, high extraction rate, is there any impact or damage which is related to that? It depends to many cases, to the fragility of the ecosystem and the location of the ecosystem. You take the low end, low extraction rate and low resources, yeah, it's like the situation of a collapse. There's no resources and that's all the way around. low extraction and low resources, so it might be also in balance. But if you have low extraction rate and high resource, then there is conservation eventually. But high extraction rate and low resources may lead to big collapse. But these are just, you know, concept and hypothesis. In reality, things which are happening are more complex than that. Intuitively, we can use this matrix to assess different places of the world and see where agroforestry is more suited exactly to make a big change in the landscape. The related challenge on biodiversity are twofold. I just suggest here two things. The issue of managing biodiversity as a trade-off of socio-economic gains. So we have all seen that the agribusiness do not really pay attention. Somebody mentioned it yesterday in a session. Do not really pay attention to the biodiversity stuff. Do we have to change the policies and have to make sure that communities are aware that high income can be relevant for a short term, but if it's at the expense of the natural capital, that will be really be detrimental to a long-term achievement of their survival goal. So how to limit damage and how to offset the net loss of biodiversity? These are key questions which we need to put on the table. The other thing is to combine high yielding and sustainability. I'm happy that the Sustainable Development Goals have included all these climate, all these environmental must-have in terms of sustainability, being climate relevant, be very resilient system. And biodiversity conservation is part of the solution. And we cannot just encourage biodiversity by pure conservation. We have to encourage biodiversity by also promoting biodiversity where people really do their productive activities, like in farmland. So agroforestry will help deliver not only services, including yield, but also biodiversity and ecosystem services. That's what we are pledging here. A research made by our former Director General Garrity estimated about more than 80%, roughly, that biodiversity resources is managed under areas where human-dominated activities are taking place. So we have to think about it. It's not only just because we want to achieve one thing. We have to achieve several things at the same time and manage the trade-off in the on-farm for considerable genetic diversity conservation, but also to promote new knowledge and innovation in terms of tree domestication to really maintain in-situ conservation of biodiversity and agrobiodiversity. When talking about conservation, the in-situ and near in-situ conservation is very, very important. And you have to do it where, you know, people are really developing crops and developing their livestock in terms of productive system. Very difficult to maneuver between very sometimes overlapping, sometimes diverging concept. But I try to reflect on the many concepts, the old land equivalent ratio, who people knows very well. Agroforestry as another concept, ecosystem management, land sharing, land sparing. You have been using those concepts many times, and recently landscape management or climate smart landscape management. When I look the content of all this, concept, which is just a sample among many, they're all addressing almost the same thing. They're all talking about landscape equilibrium and biodiversity, ecosystem, ecological process, protecting species and ecosystem, accommodating human use, etc., etc. So to me, whether you call it agroforestry, or you call it ecosystem management, or you call it climate smart agriculture, or you call it climate smart landscape, for me, doesn't matter. What is important is to see the practical implications of those concepts in the ground. And this is what makes complex the connection between policymakers. Every day there is a new concept coming in, and every concept is related to one institution. And at the end of the day, you speak the same language. And this is really hard for policymakers to follow. I made a quiz in a session, how many scientific papers is published every year across the globe? 1.4 million papers. That's 2,000 papers a day. Is there 2,000 decisions to be taken from every paper by policymakers? No. We have something, we have to do our homework. Our homework is to see how we can repackage our science and make it consistent with the policy needs, with the demand of knowledge, and have simple messaging on what needs to be done in the ground instead of just rhetoricing and trying to develop multiple concepts, which means the same thing, which finally will lose the conceptual meaning of policymakers about the practical issues. And that's what comes to this. So to simplify that, I just go to some basic, simple examples of practice of communities and farmers in Africa. On the top left, oops, where is the pointer? Is it? Okay. There's no pointer. On the top left picture, you can see a spread of a species which is called Federbia albida. Federbia albida in the Sahel has an inverse phenology. It lives during the dry season and loose leaf during the rainy season. It's very atypical. That means it's quite complementary with crops. When crops are being harvested, that's where they cover the land. It's dry and it buffers the heat of the sun, it protects the soil. When the rain season comes in, it releases all the leaves in the ground to fertilize the soil. And this has been known for millennia in Africa as a way to improve productivity. And so many tests, millions of studies showing a farm with Federbia albida without mineral fertilizer has more yield than a land without Federbia albida. It's a nitrogen fixing and has an inverse phenology. I was a consultant for FAO to do the validation of the forest resource assessment. The definition of forest by FAO uses a landscape as a farming landscape, but if you look at the density of trees, it falls easily into a forest ecosystem, as to speak, because it has a higher density of trees as compared to the definition provided by FAO. So what I want to say is that by trying to reconstruct this density, which does not jeopardize the crop production, we can improve tree cover across the globe in many ecosystems. The second, which is in the middle, is the Rift Valley in Kenya between Nairobi and Naivasha. And these people use islets and edge planting to minimize erosion and to maintain soil fertility. The use of Gravia robusta is very well known. The layered agroforestry, multi-layered agroforestry, is also something some people use in terms of just maintaining the equilibrium in terms of biodiversity, but also having multiple products for the same piece of land. You can use agroforestry to prevent erosion, as you can see on the low right picture in the slopes of Kenya, or in Senegal or Mali, Burkina Faso, a lot of acacia trees used for livestock. And fodder from trees is extremely useful during the long dry season of 9 months. We cannot just bound the success of communities with 3 months of rainfall. And in most Africa, in the dry areas of Africa, rainfall is one season and only 3 months out of 12. So we have to see ways we can use an evergreen approach where trees is the only one, is the only sort of functional type which can provide these resources around across the years. And then I was interested in looking where deforestation is taking place, and I wrote a blog which was published about the deforestation paradox in Africa. When we talk about deforestation, all big countries, they go to the Congo Basin and invest a lot of money on red. I was discussing with my friend Earl Ellis on red this morning. And looking at the deforestation pace, the Congo Basin is, yes, a big place to invest money to conserve forests, but deforestation is more crucial in a non-forested landscape, mostly in the savanna landscape, because that's where we have high population density, a lot of livestock breeding, and that's where eventually we need to improve tree cover to make sure that some sort of resilience is taking place. Look at this picture. By Brink, my colleagues from GRC, showing the bigger circles in the savanna area, the small circles around the Congo Basin. Pay attention to this graph with the forest area per country and the rate of deforestation. So many countries are falling in the low forest cover and high risk of forest loss. So if you want to conserve biodiversity and buffer the impact, the human impact on dense forests, I believe that we need to put more emphasis in the surrounding areas of the forest, of the forested land, mostly the humid tropics. Multi-million dollars have been invested in red. I have nothing against red, which is excellent, but the agroforestry landscape will be a place-based approach to provide the different ecosystem services, wood energy, improve soil fertility and water, and improve crop production. And that's what we think to promote in the World Agroforestry Center. There are many options which are possible. Whatever ecological zone you take, there is one way or another to do agroforestry practice. We try to repackage definition of agroforestry based on typology and the key element and some example of practice. And you can see that for different ecologies, there are options possible. If you want to change the physiognomy of the vegetation, mark parkland, mosaic, multi-storied home gardens, the compositional and structural, whether you do simultaneous or sequential combination of trees and crops, or functional erosion control or soil fertility or socioeconomic, or a combination of all of these. Because the farmers will never choose one objective. The farmers will have many objectives by planting just one tree. And that's what we tend to ignore. And we can't just projecting. We target ecosystem services, or we target crop production. We forget about the multifunctional need of communities by planting trees and restoring land. And the multifunctionality is also the users, how we use this agroforestry product. From nutrition to soil health, to combating disease and pests, to shade trees or wood energy, to livestock and commercial product like fruits and nuts. All of these things will probably change the livelihood of communities in the ground. And they need this. They only need crops. They only need to eat cereals. They need the other tree product which are very useful for them. And in order to have this diversity of function, we need to encourage biodiversity conservation into the agroforestry land. So many high nutritious fruits exist. When I came to Africa, like here in Spear, in the morning I can see so many fruits coming from temperate, about South Africa is a temperate ecosystem, coming from Europe in general. You go to Mali and in the morning they give you orange because that's good, it boosts your vitamin C. But there's so many fruits in Africa which has 10 times more vitamin C than orange. Baobab fruits. If you want your oligo elements, go for moringa. I don't need to have kiwi fruit to do that, etc. So, but knowing that, the importance of those local fruits and promoting it and decomplexify the relationship between people and those fruits and those agroforestry will create a big market, particularly in Africa where the urban growth is the biggest and the most rapid across the earth. So there's so many things we can do with these trees. And a new product, and many of those are sort of being discovered. We received a big international firm, I don't want to cite anyone, who came and say, if you give us a new product which has a very big potential, we will invest on it. And this Alamblakia tree, it has a seed oil which is of high value. There is now a new butter coming from Alamblakia tree. Alamblak was a very old botanist working in Africa who discovered this tree. The tree was named after him. And this oil has the property of being very stable. The oil is very stable. If you put it on ice cream, the ice cream will never melt into your hands. Imagine the business you can make out of it, as particularly in the summer, which is coming in South Africa. So this is a new product. We did not explore enough the possibilities we have with our trees. I receive, now it's almost an aggression, from some firms in the United States about moringa tree. We have to do it, Cheikh. You don't know the potential which is in agroforestry of moringa tree. Moringa has so many, every morning I get my small spoon of moringa powder because it's now commercialized in a very high price in Nairobi. And I'm sure you know it. And our parents know it because my grandmom used to put some stews in the stew, the leaves of moringa, and we did not know. And you know, we are big now and grown very, very nicely because of those fruits. So please, let's turn back a little bit into this these traditional practices, which are really giving a big impetus on achieving food security and biodiversity. Local and international market. This picture in the left is taken in Burkina Faso, not Burkina Faso, in Cameroon, in the south, in the forest of Cameroon. It's called Koleyeng, where a red project is taking place. Those poor communities, they're getting a little out of this oil palm extraction and see the labor around it. It's just a lot of people to benefit from it. The local market, they don't do a lot of transformation. Look at those buckets, it's only raw product. There's no small, only small transformation. Think about transforming those products in a very industrialized way. As the baola you have seen on the top. I was in Germany for a PhD defense, and after we finished, they came with a nice drinks, you know, those alcohol stuff, which I don't drink. I say, no, soft drink, and say, ah, we have something for you. And they bring me this baobab-based drink in Nuremberg. Say, do you have baobab in Germany? No, but we are transforming it. And it's so nice, and everybody is drinking it. And I wanted to try all of them. They give me the two bottles. So one with ginger, one another ginger. It's so sweet. Those who come from Germany, please try it. And this is the way forward, how to unlock the potential of agroforestry and make sure that we take all the market potential of it while conserving agrobiodiversity in the ground. It's not just a conservation pace. It's also combining conservation with local communities. The climate change is bad. This figure, I get a lot of trouble with Bob Skoll, who was a reviewer of this a reviewer of this Kosciusko paper, and the editor is here. So many questions. So, but Bob, I managed to include all your remarks, and it works out very nicely. So how agroforestry is going from livelihood to address the mutual need of mitigation and adaptation. And there are so many overlaps. If you want to address the dual need of mitigation and adaptation, agroforestry is one of the exceptional activities that can combine both. And I will let you just read what are the possibilities of doing that. But let's take this matrix. And so many practices also we have to get rid, I mean, not get rid of, but to manage better. There are some activities which in terms of adaptation are very positive, but in terms of mitigation, which is a low axis, is very negative. Negative adaptation, integral adaptation, protection of forests. People do not have access to the forest. That's not good for adaptation, but that's very good for mitigation. That's some of this approach for excluding communities to access the resources. But we have places where we have both positive mitigation and positive adaptation, and agroforestry is part of those solutions. So we have to think about this when it comes to responding to climate change. There is not a single approach on agroforestry. It requires site-specific assessment. It's not a silver bullet. Every situation requires a set of options which we need to be addressed. But what is the status of studies in the world? This recent one, which is published this year, shows when it comes to connecting agroforestry with ecosystem services and the valuation of ecosystem services, agroforestry in Africa does not come on the top list. It's more about ecological economics and other things. It's about the cash. But our study, we did another study for Journal of Applied Ecology, which shows when you question agroforestry in terms of biodiversity conservation, then agroforestry come on the top. That's a contradiction, but we have to see why people are more interested in agroforestry for conservation rather than for ecosystem services, because they just use the wild to do that. I borrowed this from an incoming book, and Eric Toins something, I forget the name, about the potential of land suitability for developing biodiversity in agroforestry. There are some which are high to very high, forest regeneration, but for most of them, there's some potential we can develop for biodiversity. Our studies use this model for stock taking. We have investigated more than 800 papers about agroforestry and ecosystem conservation, and found out three main reasons why we should do it: maintaining flocks, maintaining biodiversity species, and preventing control of fire and erosion. And then the results show the issue of scale. So many local studies, but a great deal of regional and subnational studies. And in the left, you have the ecosystem services provided almost most of them, except the cultural one, because people want to have more provisioning from agroforestry or supporting and regulation. It's very clear in the study that those are most important, and this is a multifunctional response of agroforestry as expected from our study. In terms of biodiversity conservation, both in situ and ex situ, people are importing, yes, people are importing a lot of species into their land in order to have some resource out of it. And in terms of location gaps, geographical gaps, I always mention we do a lot of research where we have budget for. We don't do research where decision needs to be taken. If you take Africa, in terms of agroforestry, there is not much on the northern Africa and even in the central African basin. And as you can see here, East Africa and Southern Africa are the places where you only have a relevant set of information. I think because they all speak English and they publish in English peer-reviewed paper, which is dominant. And if you take Central and West Africa, although there is a lot of literature, they tend to be very limited representation into this process. And I think PECS as a global program, and it show into the picture at the introduction, your geographical representation, we have to do something about it to have the various perspective into it. So some approaches, Belinda mentioned this pyramid of aim, and based on, but I take the various, what is the prerequisite? Are we talking the same language? Are we using the same concept? Are we understanding what we want to achieve the same way? And then if you take that prerequisite, considering the multifunctionality and multiple scale, we implement, and that's where the co-implementation comes in. It's not only co-design, because the co-implementation is a learning process, and then we can achieve the aim. But agroforestry landscape are one of the land use systems among others. It's not only one. And it should be integrated in order to be responding to the biodiversity requirement. So many influences and modulators around, you know, agroforestry from national to international, but also at local level, the issue of motivation, the issue of rights, the issue of incentives can shape the actual agroforestry system. The issue of scales, of course, every agroforest system has some set of scale-related aspect which needs to be considered if you want to go from pilot to a bigger picture. And recapitulating all this agroforestry use, you can see so many needs and keywords coming from the literature, but all of them are responding to one thing, multifunctionality, and we have to think about multifunctionality when it comes to agroforestry. So the four key messages are here, which is on my last slide. We are far from achieving multiple functions. We have to see how much we can develop that through agroforestry and biodiversity conservation. We have to see how to develop the interaction and co-investment, because it needs investment. It needs, it's knowledge intensive. It's a practice to negotiate among different actors. Climate is not one thing. It's really many. It's one driver among others. And we always think about climate. We're going to COP, and many things on INDC in Africa will be related to land processes. And we don't see land processes as only related to climate, but other things. And agroforestry need a grounded in local reality, so we need to develop the options for different contexts, the right tree for the right place. And this is the end of my presentation, and hope I convince you. I'm trying to be a good preach, but I think it was a clear message that we need agroforestry to change the livelihood and landscape for Africa. Thank you.